Foundation. Ikra is a publisher and producer of Islamic educational textbook for children. And the founder of Ikra, one of the co-founders, is Dr. Fatima Ghazi, who is with us. Maybe she can just kind of share the wave her hand. And one of the passions that you will find if you have an opportunity to work with Dr. Fatima, she loves children. You know, there are a few people who, you know, talk about, many of us talk about this idea of doing something, you know, amazing, giving ourselves to something we're passionate about, but there are very few people who actually take that step and follow that path, and Dr. Fatima is one of those people. And this particular event, you know, why would she sponsor an event like this? She loves children and felt like this would be an opportunity for children to appreciate music within our tradition. So we're very excited for that. Also, the location of this place, we're hosting this event at American Islamic College. And, you know, while just before coming here, I was putting some things on Facebook, reminiscing about how I used to, you know, sneak in and play basketball. And, you know, I didn't get over here. It's a little story that some of you guys might, you know, remember about. But now coming back after 25 years and seeing the growth of this organization and seeing where it's come is really a testament to the leadership. And Dr. Oni, who's here, you know, definitely giving credit for that. His representative, Susan Ronan, who's the program coordinator, will just share a few words.
Started working with Dawud as a songwriter. A lot of seniors in the Muslim community, they're very used to poets and songwriters, and it's really great to be around Dawud, to have Dawud, our kind of songwriter. And I've been around me, I've seen everyone, and I've seen all those musicians that I respect them all. But there are very few true poets. And so it's incredible to welcome Dawud back to the U.S. to go overseas for some years. And for me, Dawud, he's the poet who envisioned Pakistan, the creation of Pakistan. And he had a line of poetry that I really loved. He said, Urdu, which translates to, he said that the role of the poet is that the poet puts the mirror in front of the community. And they look in that mirror and they see themselves who they truly are. And sometimes you might get in, sometimes you don't. But the poet is our reflective lens. And I think that Dawud and Jay Lama have been like a soundtrack of our life. And when I grow up every year, like, my Eve was going to send me the new Dawud albums, and I'm saying that Road to Medina and on and on. But he has been the mirror for our community. And I hosted two interview shows. But I always waited for Dawud to come back overseas, because any musician, I just wrote any musician, any songwriter, any human being would be Dawud Wharnsby. So let's give him a big, big welcome. She's a very talented, very humble Dawud Wharnsby.
Thank you for being here tonight. Could have been anywhere else on a Friday night. It's so wonderful to be here with you. It's a pleasure to be here at the Islamic University. I've never been here before. First time here is facility. And I can't ask myself why I've never been here before in 20 years. So it's great to be here. And it's wonderful to be hosted again in part by my friends at ICRA, who have been such warm and caring supporters for the past many, many years. So be a host for the hopefully we'll have many more decades of trying to inspire young people and motivate young people using creative ways. One of the reasons why I love performing in the States, since it's so nice to be back in North America now after so many years away in Pakistan. It's because of that diversity that we see here in America and Canada. These are countries we live in that are made up of so many of us who come from so many different parts of the world. And when I look around this beautiful audience here and I see so many of your families who have come tonight, I can see that a lot of you look like you might have come from a few different countries at least. Anybody here from Pakistan? Anybody here whose family comes from the Middle East somewhere? Anybody here from Europe? So I'm guessing this. Some of you probably know how to say hello in some other languages. Anybody want to say hello in another language? Yep. No.
That's okay, so am I.
Yep.
Marhaba, what language is that? Arabic, lovely.
Yeah. How about yourself? Yeah, how can you say hello in another language? Sophie. Do you want to say hello in another language? How about Sophie?
You just want hola.
Hola. What language is that? Spanish, right?
No.
Yes. Do you know what language is that? Korean. Beautiful.
I've never heard anybody shout that out before. Very nice.
One more. Yes.
Moni.
Moni, what language is that? From Africa. Oh, beautiful. You see, that's one of the beautiful things that can bring us all together. It's just by learning a greeting in another language. A good friend of mine is a drummer. He used to spend a lot of his time drumming in various different places. He used to do a lot of drumming in old retirement homes where there would be a lot of elderly people whose families had sort of just given them away to sort of have someone else care for them. And there was one particular place that he went one time, and there was a lot of elderly people sitting together, and he would bring his drums and get them all the drums together, trying to get them to loosen up. And there was one gentleman who refused to drum. He would just sit in his chair like this. And the ladies and gentlemen who worked in this particular hospital, they used to say to my friend John Levine, they said, "Don't even worry about that guy. He won't do anything. He doesn't talk to anybody. He just sits in his chair like this." Well, our friend Jamaluddin, he didn't want to sell for that. He thought there must be something going on in the mind of this man. So as he was drumming, and all the people were drumming together, and this man just sat in his chair like this. Jamal would go up to him, and as he passed by with his drum, he would say things like, "Ni hao!" Anybody know what that means? Hello in Chinese.
And then that man just sat in his chair.
And then he passed by, he said, "Bonjour!" In French, hello in French, and the man just sat there. And he tried all the languages he knew how to say hello in those languages. And finally, one time he passed by with his drum and he said, "Salaam alaikum." And that man, you know,
lifted his head up like this.
And then he looked at Jamaluddin with these bright, bright eyes. And Jamal stopped his drumming. He got him really close and he said, "Salaam alaikum." And the man started to nod. And Jamal said again, "Assalamu alaikum." And before long, that man had a tear in his eye. And it turned out that the elderly gentleman was from Turkey. And he hadn't heard anyone say "Assalamu alaikum" to him for years and years and years. And just that one phrase, that one greeting, was enough to bring him out of his shell. And this song here is an old song. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years old. An old Hebrew melody. Because if I look around the world, high and low, and the only two languages I can find, two cultures, two groups of people that greet each other with a greeting of peace, are the Arab culture, we Muslims, and our friends who speak Hebrew, from the Jewish culture, they greet each other with the word shalom. Everybody say shalom. This is an old Hebrew melody called shalom. It's really simple. I want you to try and see if you can sing it with me, so I don't have to do all the work. But it's like this. Shalom, shalom, shalom. May peace be with you, may peace be with you. Shalom, shalom. Shalom, 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 shalom. May peace be with you, may peace be with you. Shalom, shalom.
And you'd like to sing along? How many of you like to sing? Put up your hand if you'd like to sing. Try it with me, I guarantee you. You'll be the only group of Muslims in Chicago singing Shalom tonight.
Shalom Aleichem, Shalom Aleichem, Shalom, Shalom. May peace be with you, may peace be with you. Shalom, Shalom, Shalom Aleichem, Shalom, Shalom. May peace be with you, may peace be with you. Shalom,
Shalom. We always talk about peace in the world, peace in the Middle East, but we're never going to find peace if we don't know how to say peace in each other's languages. So I thought it would be nice to combine those refrains from that old Hebrew melody, Shalom, my friend, put them together with those Arabic words from the Quran that we all know, Assalamu alaikum. And what I'm going to do is kind of like reading those two cultures, those two traditions, those two communities, those two faiths. And it sounds like this.
Assalamu alaikum wa alaykum assalam. I greet you with the greeting of peace and the shade of your hand. Assalamu alaykum wa alaykum assalam. I greet you with peace of peace of peace to spread throughout the land. As we look towards the time in which we try to do what's right, I will greet you with peace for us, my friend, in peace through days and nights.
Try with me.
Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum assalam. I wish you with the greeting of peace and the shake of your hand. Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum assalam. I wish you with peace of peace of peace to spread throughout the land. As we look to our hands and turn to our left, as we look to your right, I will wish you with peace for us. My friend, the smile of life would ignite. Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum assalam. I reach you with the greeting of peace and the shade of your hand. Assalamu alaikum wa alaikum assalam. I reach you with peace of peace of peace to spread throughout the land. Shalom alaikum, shalom alaikum, shalom, shalom. May peace be with you, may peace be with you. Shalom, 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 alaikum, shalom, alaikum, shalom, shalom. May peace be with you, may peace be with you. Shalom, 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 shalom.
Thank you. I've been finding myself singing at schools all over the place. And even I'm in schools a few times a year, I go over there and do tours for 2 and 3 weeks at a time, visiting 2 and 2 schools a day sometimes, a lot of schools. And here in North America now, I'm being back, working in schools again, it's been really nice. And my goodness. It's great to see so many people just showing up at one time. Come on in. You sure you're America? I hope so.
Usually people stand up and leave my concerts out there. They don't just show up.
Welcome, welcome. This is a song I love to sing at schools, especially. It talks a little bit about that word shalom, or salam, sorry, peace, the reading of peace. And its focus is kind of on trying to bring our communities together. We hear a lot of people talking about peace in the world, as I say, but how many of us are actually actively trying to work for peace? Hopefully all of us. And there's a verse in the song that I love, that I dedicate to the grown-ups in the audience. Because when I meet a lot of young people, like yourselves, a lot of young people in the audience today, and I ask them, who causes all the problems in the world? We realize it's not the grannies and the grandpas and the moms and the dads and the teachers. Usually, it's grown-ups who go to school, and we all go to school, and they're going to read and write and count. And when they finish school, and they get out into the world, and they become the presidents and kings and queens and prime ministers of our countries and lands, they remember how to read and write and count, especially count, because everybody loves to count their money. But they forget the most important thing, which is how to get along with each other. Imagine if you're in school, if you just got in a fight with someone in the playground, and you said, you're going to wage war on you, you're bringing terror to the school yard. I'm going to wage war on you. You'd end up in the principal house pretty quickly.
So the second verse of this song is dedicated to the grown-ups in the world,
who, like all of us, we get in trouble sometimes, especially us husbands, and need to be sent to our rooms to cool down. There's a lot of grown-ups in the world that I think need to be sent to their rooms too. I call this song "Hi Neighbor," "Salam Neighbor." And definitely, some of my songs work better in schools than others.
I've always tried to take that same philosophy to my own writing. It's just write songs that kind of come from the heart of hope that maybe will go to other people's hearts. And this is one of those songs. This is one of my younger friends in the audience. They may not quite understand the words. That's what the grown-ups might not either. But the song is a little bit about trying to understand better who we are. And one of the ways that I feel we can do this is when we spend more time outdoors. You know, when you're out in nature, you can be around those natural environments. And on tour over the past few months, my friend Saad, one of the things that's been most beautiful about visiting different communities like yours is that somehow we've discovered this silent majority of people. People who might go to the mosque, go to the synagogue, the church, on our day of worship, but might not always quite feel that they can connect as well in those environments with other people or with other neighbors. And sometimes those of us who make up that silent majority need to remember that imams and rabbis and priests, they don't define God to us or for us. God is far beyond all of us. And it's up to each one of us to find that connection with God, to define how we are going to live our lives, instead of being sheep, you know, to be shepherds and follow the example of those prophets who went before us. And this is a song a little bit about all that. And for those of you that might not quite understand the words, maybe you just close your eyes, because I wrote the song after a dream I had about flying. Now, in my dream, I was flying, and all the people came and asked me when I landed, "How did you fly? How did you do it?" And I said, "You know what? You don't have to try so hard. All you have to do is just relax and be yourself. And you'll start to fly." So maybe those of you that are in the audience want to close your eyes and listen to the words, you can imagine you're flying and figure out what you want to be. This song's called "Out Seeing the Field." Self-subsisting as possible, and own my own water, and wash my own clothes, and living in Boston is a little easier to have that simplicity, I find. We live in other places too. My wife had to be in Syria for a while, and we're so saddened to see what's going on in Syria these past few months. If there's anybody here whose families are in Syria, please know that our prayers are with you. One of the things that I find I turn to how be kinder simply is always remember very basic fundamentals of that Muhammad Rasulullah. To me, it represents this idea that as human beings we all come from that same source of energy, life, Allah. And therefore, we should have a little humility because we're all equal as human beings. And Muhammad Rasulullah always reminds me that there's no others before us who've been seeking that wisdom and that balance and that simplicity too. And all those prophets have come, thousands of them, to every nation and tribe. Always had that guidance. We can maybe have enough humility to look to their wisdom. We might not keep trying so hard to reinvent the wheel. So this song is a little bit about that. We're trying not to follow those things that lead us off the track, like money, or power, or our own egos. And I had the pleasure this past year of recording, actually, with a wonderful, wonderful woman in Pakistan, Deepa Kiani, an incredible singer, and we did an Urdu English version of this. I'll spare you my cookie tonight though. Call the war.
Thank you.
when those like the beat in mine will show. Featuring the star of all that I am, I love one little soul. And I
Younger folks, how about this young lady right here? You want to come up and help me out? Come on up. There's some stairs right over there, I think. And another young man.
Is there a young gentleman somewhere in the audience? How about this guy here? Come on up. I'm going to give this to you. Come on over here. I'm going to give. Come on over. Don't be shy. There we go. Give those to you.
We've not met each other before, but you guys can help me out with this next song. And it's really, really simple. One of the things I always remember,
in fact, I was talking with my brother here earlier tonight, he was saying how he wished he had learned some sort of music growing up. And I know there's a lot of formal ways that people teach music, and a lot of people who are very, you know, scholarly when it comes to music, and they might be really upset with me telling you this, but coming from someone like myself who didn't fare so well in school, and more self-taught when it came to poetry and music, music to me is not so much about how you sound when you sing or when you play, but it's about how well you're able to listen. A lot of people think music is about the noise you make, but really music is about how well you listen and fit in with the music around you. In fact, scholars of our faith, scholars of the Quranic teachings have said in the past that music is actually about trying to create sound which is harmonious with nature. When you create something which is in harmony with nature or in rhythm with nature, then this creates something beautiful. And beauty, of course, is from all of us, or it's all beauty. So we're going to try that tonight. I don't want you to worry too much about what you play. I want you to just feel the beat. I'm going to get the beat going on the guitar. I want you to try and join in with that rhythm. You can help us out with some snapping or clapping, whatever it's your fancy. And the song is all about the rhythm of creation around us. Now we have to find a way to fit into that. Sometimes it's hard for us, but we can do this. You want to try with me? Ready to go? All right, beat's really simple. It goes like this.
You hate the rhythm of creation, the rhythm of laughing, the thunder and the rain. You see the rhythm of creation, the lightning and the beat, and the beat and the tears. As the shoe went in the field, spinning round and round, lost and taken back and confused, and all at one time. Creation, the rhythm of life.
As I say about music and singing, some people, they think it's more about sound meaning instead of about listening. And a lot of times parents and teachers will come to me and say, "Oh, I think you should write a song about this, write a song about that." And I always say to them, "No, you do it yourself." Because really, that's all I do. And the reason I write songs for them is because I can't afford a counselor. And it's a very therapeutic way of trying to deal with the things in life that we're experiencing every day in our lives. And I always tell my audiences that we are a lot like pop bottles. We're a lot like a bottle of Sprite or Pepsi. Inside of us, we've got every experience that has ever happened to us in our short lives or in our long lives. And all of those experiences build up inside, just like a computer hard drive. They get all packed in there. And if you take a bottle of Sprite or 7-Up, and you pop the lid, what's going to happen if you shake it? It's going to explode, right?
Yes.
And we're no different. If we don't deal with our emotions and our feelings in the right way, we pop out at the wrong time and place. And so, writing and singing can be a powerful tool for allowing those feelings to come out in the right way. And so if you've got an idea for something, don't underestimate the power of your own pen. Because that pen that you've got and that brain that you've got is no different than the pen and the brain that I've got. In fact, you're probably worth a lot better than mine. So put that pen to the page. And in fact, one song which proves this, and I'd love to use this as an example, is a song that a lot of people come to me and they say, "There's a song you wrote, the best song you ever wrote." Anybody heard this story before? Some of you might not have heard this story. I hope you haven't, because it's a true story. They come to me, they say, "It's the best song you ever wrote. Can you sing it?" I'll say, "Well, I've written so many songs. What song is it?" They say, "Oh, brother, this is your best song." And I try to stay humble, but it's hard sometimes when people come right up to you and they say, "It's the best song you ever wrote." Thank you so much. Tell me what it is.
They say, "We play that song in our car on the way to school, on the way home from school. My mother puts us to sleep with that song." I say,
"Thank you very much. Please, you tell me, what is the best song ever?" And it doesn't matter whether in Malaysia, South Africa, or Pakistan, people always say, "The best song we ever wrote is a song called The Blue Sky is Blue, Like Blue Bubblegum." Has anybody heard that song before?
Oh, you know what? Is it the best song I ever wrote?
No. Remind me to drop this percentage next time. Well, I'll tell you a little secret. That song, "The Blue Sky is Blue, Like Blue Bubblegum," the best song I ever wrote, I never wrote. Now, it was actually written by a friend of mine. And the interesting thing about this guy is that when he wrote the song, he didn't mean to write it. It was kind of an accident. And when that happened, he was only 4 years old. Anybody in the audience here who's 4 years old? These young ladies over here are 4. So this song, it was written by someone who was just your age. Now he's 17 years old, and he insists he did not write the song. He's pretty cool. Because he doesn't even remember when it happened. But he used to say things to me. He'd say, "I don't want to be a grown-up. Because the grown-ups I've seen, they don't get down on the floor enough and play with toys. And when I'm a grown-up, I don't want to be one." And I would write those words down. Well, I was working on a new album at the time, and I ran a song that I had written, and I started to find these little note papers with his words on them. And I started to piece them together. And every once in a while, he'd also sing this little song. Just on his own. He'd sing it when he was in the bathtub or in the backseat of the car, in his car. He'd sing, "The blue sky is blue, like blue bubble gum, but it prays to Allah, it prays to Allah." And I just finished off a few words and I sang, "Like the flavor of the blue sky and the bubble gum will pass. We've got to thank Allah before our chances go past. We've got to thank Allah before our chances go past. I don't want to be a grown-up like the grown-ups I've seen, cause the grown-ups I've seen don't seem to have much fun. They don't get down on the floor enough to play or play with toys. When I'm a grown-up, I don't want to be
siblings together get a sound at the ride. The blue sky is blue light.
Just come out in January. I was tired of just making CDs, because CDs end up as posters, they end up under the seat of the car or something, but books is something a little more lasting. Long after my voice is withered and worn and I've been planted somewhere under a lilac tree, I'm hoping that the words of these songs will carry on for other generations. And it's more beautiful, I find, although I love being here with you and singing on stage with you, I think it's more beautiful when I receive emails and letters from people who say, I've been singing your songs with my grandchildren, and we've been reading your songs. This is a new book called A Picnic of Poems. It's 30 new poems for children and families. There is a CD in the back that you can enjoy and share with your families as well. In fact, I kept this simple too. I recorded the whole CD on my laptop computer with a zero budget. Just to prove to people that you don't need a big recording studio and managers and agents and all those people to write music and songs. You can do that at home with your family, right on my laptop. My daughter, Sophia, she's only 1 year old. My other daughter, Mary, she's 4. They sing on CD with me. My wife helped me to write some of the songs. And my friend, Shireen, in England, she even used some pictures from my family scrapbook at home and our photo album at home to create some of the illustrations. You might even be able to see this, and I can see it. Does that look like anybody might recognize? So this is a book of new poems and songs for your family, for my family. And in fact, I'd like to share this one with you, if I may. It's one of my favorite ones in the book. My daughter, when she looked at my beard, she said, "Hey, what's in your beard?" I said, "What's in my beard? I don't know. What are you talking about?" She said, "What color is my beard?"
Gray. Yes, that's right. You see?
She saw the gray hair. What's that meaning? Don't ask me any sugar on it. I said, "No, no, it's not sugar. This is white hair." I said, "White hair." She said, "Why?" I said, "Because I'm getting old." She said, "Who's going to take care of me?"
Don't worry, I got a few good years left for me yet.
But I wrote this song for her called My Father's Beard. And it goes like this.
My father has no whiskers, a beard that's so curly, and when he tries to kiss my cheek, it's always rubbing me. He teases and he tickles my neck and meet my chin. His beard puts me in giggles, and now long last begin. Within his whiskey whiskers, I notice something new, starting between the brown ones white hair smoking through. He says his beard is changing from brown to wintry white. And each new strand of silver is like a bit of light. He says the more he loves me, the more his love will grow. For as his love gets stronger, the more white hairs will show. My father has the whiskers, a beard that's so curly. And when he tries to push my cheek, it's always scrubbing me. He teases and he tickles my neck and beneath my chin. His beard puts me in giggles, and now the long laughs begin.
Now my daughter was pretty happy with that explanation as to why my hair was turning white. Then she said, yeah, but how do you put that thing on your head? Thing on my head? What do you want to have a thing on my head?
What's going on with that in my head?
Yeah, some kid abused me and told me I had a hole in the head. Wouldn't be surprised at that.
It's true, my hair started falling out a few years ago. Every morning I'd wash my hair in the sink and I'd see the hair going down the drain with my self-esteem. I tried to think of ways to explain to my daughter why my hair was falling out. And finally I thought, well, you know, maybe in February this is the problem. I travel all over the place singing songs, being away from home so much. When I'm gone, when I travel, I miss you and your sister so much. And I think about you, until my brain gets really, really hot, and then
my hair falls out.
She was pretty happy with that explanation too, but didn't do much for my self-esteem, unfortunately. Until the day, she wanted to ride on my shoulders. And I knew you, have you ever ridden on your parents' shoulders? Maybe when you were younger, you might have rode them. My daughters loved to ride on my shoulders. And one day, I picked up my little girl, I put her up on my shoulders, and she's so happy to be up there, she wanted to give me a kiss. And the only place she could find to kiss me was... So brothers, if you're losing your hair, don't worry about it. It's not actually called baldness, it's actually a target for kisses. My father has some whiskers, a beard that's so cuddly. And when he tries to touch my cheek, it's always scrubbing me. He teases and he tickles my neck and beneath my chin. His beard puts me in giggles, and now the long laughs begin.
Thank you.
I mentioned as well that my wife helped me write one of the songs too. This is a song which is inspired by the rose tree in our yard. And if you've ever seen a rose tree, or if you have a rose tree in your yard, especially the springtime coming, you might notice that roses do something really interesting when the rain comes. Does anybody know what a rose flower does when the rain comes?
Yep.
It grows.
Yes,
but it also does something else. Roses are very fragile flowers, so when the rain starts to hit them, they do something to try and protect themselves. Yep. They close. Yeah. A giant rose flower will close up into a tiny little flower. And if you didn't know any better, and you passed a rose bush with all of the flowers closed up, you might think it was actually kind of a very peculiar looking tree. You might think it was actually really ugly. It's just a stick with thorns all over it. You might wonder, what kind of shrub is this? And unfortunately, I find a lot of people the same way. A lot of times, we are very beautiful, wonderful things we can share with the world, a lot of color in who we are, but because we might get a little afraid when we're in a new place or when we meet new people, we kind of close up. And we just sort of stand there. And a lot of people might pass us by and just think we're a prickly old stick. And I think maybe if we open ourselves up more, try to be, stop being so afraid, and to let those colors that we have out, imagine how beautiful this world would be. This song is simply called The Rose. I wonder if the thorny sweet and rose, that one day it will blossom and will grow a lovely rose. I wonder of my own life, what is it of me? The prettiest if I am, will I become a tree? Roots so deep and strong, my arms up to the sky. Bring cool shades, sweet fruits and flowers to those who pass me by. God gives us choices to grow in better ways. Our best is yet to come as long as we wait two new days. So though today is small, there will come an hour. Tomorrow may be my day to blossom, bloom and flower if it's meant to be.
and God will do it for me. I will beautify this world like a rose for shortened dream. I want to live the corny sweet even knows that one day it will blossom and will grow a lovely rose. I want to love my own land, far as it I'll be. The sweet little stick I am when I become a tree. Roots so deep and strong, my arms up to the sky. Bring tomorrow maybe my dear thoughts will do the power if it's meant to be. And God will do it for me. I will beautify this world like a rose for a shortened tree. Just be patient with me, we'll wait and see.
So much.
My my friends in the audience, younger friends in the audience too, you can maybe help me out with this next song from where you're sitting. This is an example of one of those songs I was talking about earlier, something which isn't just for children or isn't just for grown-ups. So it's a song which I hope is kind of for everybody. And if you've been following my songs over the years, my humble little offerings and opinions, you'll know that I'm the type of person that doesn't like to just sing happy songs about bugs and critters all the time. I like to be on a soapbox once in a while too, and feel some important sayings that other people might be afraid to say, even if most people are thinking of or feeling them in their hearts. I try not to let the fear of what other people think of me get in the way of what I write and what I say. So this is a song that was inspired about my life in Pakistan. And so maybe you can help me out a bit. How many of you in the audience, my younger friends here, have heard of what a crow sounds like before? Yeah. Can you make a crow sound for me?
Beautiful.
Exactly. In fact, to me, crows, they kind of sound like they're laughing. They're like, where I live in Pakistan, we have a lot of sheep and goats and cows, but we also have a lot of crows. And my daughter Ryan asked me one time, what are they laughing at? And I thought about it long and hard, and I realized, I think I kind of found the answer. You see, where I live, sound called Abbottabad. Some of you may have heard about it in the news recently. I know that we have some interesting neighbors.
But
we also live near a military school. So not only do you hear the sheep and the cows and the goats, but we also hear sounds like this. What does that sound like to you?
Gunfire, yeah.
Because while I'm on my balcony practicing my instrument of music, other young men are being taught to shoot instruments of war, being told that maybe they can be powerful and strong if they learn how to take someone else's life. And I think that's kind of a little creepy, actually. And sometimes people ask me about music. They say, brother, we've heard it somewhere, we heard it in this hand, the music isn't loud. And I say, well, you know what? Lots of people have lots of opinions. The prophet has said it wasn't loud, but a lot of people have a lot of opinions. And I've come to a personal sort of belief that when all of the scholars and theologians around the world, Muslim teachers and scholars, when it comes to a consensus and an opinion that instruments of war, like guns and bombs and tanks, are haram, maybe I'll take their opinions on musical instruments a little bit more seriously as well. And until that time, I'll write songs like this for the children to enjoy and for the grown-ups to hopefully enjoy as well. I'll just use these to write songs and books for the children, with the hopes that the grown-ups will read those books to the children and maybe learn a thing or two as well. And this is a song I call Dear Mr. Crow. And you can help me out by making some crow noises in the middle of the song. I'm going to ask you to give your cue, because the crow noises can be really sort of haunting. The song sounds a little bit like this. Makes you laugh way up there in that tree, with your caw, 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 crackle, haw, haw, haw. What is it that you see? Dear little child, people caw, caw.
far below. Thinking they're more free than a bird at me, flying each place I go. Fences and boards, the walls and flags, all caught us so far ranged. The foolish big boys who fight with the toys are so sad they sing. Dear little child, I'll tell you now, call is just my view. This world is so fast, but it won't ever last, so change by those I do.
You hear your crow noises.
Nice one. This world is so vast, it won't ever last, so change by those I do. Dear Mr. Crow, what makes you laugh, way up there in that tree? With your haw, 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 crackle, haw, 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 what is it that you see? Dear little child, I'll tell you now, haw, haw, it's just my view. This world is so vast, but won't ever last, till she comes out. This world is so vast, but won't ever last, till she comes out.
Comes from Arabic. The first time the word guitar was ever used in this form of guitar was actually by Arab scholars in Spain. And a banjo, someone mentioned banjo, the banjo is a long ass instrument that's got sort of a drum on the face. So that not only do you get the rhythm and the sound of the string, but you also get a bit of a little rhythm to it. The banjo actually comes from West Africa. It was also developed by Muslims in West Africa, brought over, the style of the instrument brought over to America, the concept with the slave trade. And it turned out to be a lot of African Americans in the turn of the century who began to sort of develop the banjo and made the banjo popular in the 1920s with ragtime music and with jazz music. And the mandolin, how it was first invented, was not quite as thin as this. It usually has a big round back on it. Came from Spain. It's a direct descendant of the oud, which I know that here at the Islamic University they have oud classes as well. And oud, which in Arabic means wood, is an instrument which was also developed by Muslims back in the Middle East and in parts of North Africa. So it's fascinating that all the instruments you named, the guitar, banjo, mandolin, with the exception of the ukulele, were directly a part of our history, those of us who call ourselves Muslims. And that's why I'd like to share a song here on mandolin, a little song which comes from the book, Picking the Palms. I call it All of Us.
All of us riding in the same bus, sharp at the same walls and doors. All of us debate and discuss, decide and divide. was mine was yours.
Yes, there are piles of smiles on the ground. Yes, there are piles. thank you. I'll finish off with the...
Okay. I'll make it a method. How about that? I'll finish off with one last one as well, which, you know, when I first wrote that song, Whisper of Peace.
Did you want to say something? Some of the kids want to come up and sing Whisper of Peace. Is that possible?
We could try it, maybe, if they want to. Actually, maybe we'll just do it from our show. Maybe we'll have a request. Some of the kids want to come sing it together. But it's the Myers and Things as well, so I don't want to get too many kids up at one time. But I want you to try and sing along with me if you can, from where you're sitting. I wrote that song a long time ago. And one of the reasons I wrote that song is because, I'm not quite sure this is my last little clip out of the evening. One of the reasons why I sort of was drawn to the Quran was because as a young man, I really felt as if the world called religion is very divisive. It's about sort of dividing people. This is my group and your group, and I often talk about Muslims and non-Muslims, or Christians and non-Christians. I always felt it was really dividing us. And the more I read in the various scriptures, the Bible and the Gita and the Quran, the more I saw the similarities. And one of the things I loved about the Quran was that even our testimony of faith, our kalima, la ilaha illallah, is a negation of everything except for the oneness of this creator, God's always being. And one of the things I loved is that word deen, that we often throw around and we mistranslate as what? Religion. It isn't religion. The word deen actually comes from the root word for debt. Something that you're obliged to account for, as in yawm al-deen, the day of judgment, the day of reckoning. And that word Islam is actually a verb, the action of entering into peace. And I thought, well, this is something universal for all of us. So in my little brainless mind, this idea that there is only one truth in this universe, as true as gravity, as true as oxygen, as true as the understanding of just having that unity between all of us as human beings created from that one God. But if we can permeate that, spread that understanding, that paradigm of Islam, maybe we will find some peace. And just like whispers can be whispers of gossip spreading around the world to tear people down. I know a lot of people like to gossip and say that Dawud, you know, Muslim music is an appreciative hippie, like to sing feel good songs and get money from Muslims. Whatever. You got time for another one, more power to you. But I am a hippie who likes to bring people together with songs, and I feel that A Whisper of Peace is one of those songs which I hope would spread like a whisper. With the help of some of my dear friends here in Chicago, actually, Sound Vision, who really helps me get some of those songs out in those early days. This is one of those songs, and if you know it, I want you to try and sing it with me.
A whisper of peace moving through the land. Allah surely comes to us if we hold out our hand. A word of hope, a call to everyone and man. I am to the end of time, this is how we stand. A whisper of peace moving through the land. Allah surely comes to us if we hold out our hand. A word of hope, a call to every woman and man. And until the end of time, this is how we stand. A whisper of peace moving through the land. Allah surely comes to us, but do we understand? A word of call to everyone and then I am to the end of time. Is this just a waste of time? What if we run out of time? Where is our man? If we beat the drums of hope and faith, we will all fall into rhythm. I have faith in you and I. If we beat the drums of hope and faith, and we will feel the rhythm for our footsteps transcribing, marching to the ground as we strive. I am to the end of time. This is how the sun.
Thank you so much.
I have two little girls now, four and a little over a year, as I told you. And last poem that I wrote, last one is in this book. It's my little effort to try and help them understand Allah, God. And as I sat down with Shabaya to write the song, I realized how arrogant of me to think that I can teach my children about God Almighty. So many times when we look at ourselves as teachers and educators, we can get our job to impart knowledge to the other less knowledgeable than us. But really, I don't even know what's going on behind me right now, much less describe and explain this unseen being that's created everything in this universe, my own daughter. And the song ended up turning out to be a little bit more of an autobiographical sort of prayer for myself. But I hope maybe, if anything, my daughters will grow up learning that this being, this force of energy, this Allah, this God, this Yahweh, whatever we call it around the world, is, as it says in the Quran, closer to them than their regular veins. And they don't need daddy to explain that to them. They just need to open their ears and their eyes and their senses and their hearts. And they may find that they understand it all for themselves. I wrote this song for them, and for myself, and for you. It's called Dear God. Dear God, I've heard your name from teachers, family, and friends. You made the universe and say, will it all let it end? But everyone I know admits they've never seen your face. They're not sure where you live and have no map to the base. Or a postcard could be mailed. Since I didn't have your address, that idea kind of failed. My mom told me that I could talk to you if I just pray. So God love me, I am, though I'm not sure just what to say. She said I'd never see you, but she said you're never fast asleep, and somehow you're always aware. She said that you'd remember me if I remember you. Said you'd always help me if I ever asked you to. I am just one child made out of millions of guests. I try my best, but sometimes even that turns out a mess. So I'd like you to help me with the stuff that I find up. Like feeling sad and lonely, or like I'm not good enough. I'm trying to pay the debt, somehow give something back to you. Since you ordered everything, there's not much I can do. The only thing that comes to mind to make this all seem fair is to thank you and remember that you are always there. Dear God, teachers, family, and friends, you made the universe, and so will it all let it end. The only thing that comes to mind to make this all seem fair is to thank you and remember that you are.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you very much for being here tonight.
All right,
I'm going to stick around for a while. I'll meet you up front, and if you want to get a chance to chat a little bit for a high five or bump or whatever it is you do here in Chicago, I'm happy to chat with you in a few moments.
Thank you so much. I'll try and tell off some of my sweat, and I'll meet you up front.
Thank you so much.
Assalamu alaikum.
Can we give a big hand to Mr. Dawud?
Alright, the real person I want to give a standing ovation to is already standing up. Ikra Foundation, really, can we give a big up hand to the Haji and the Wharnsby family? Growing up, you know, I didn't grow up in the Chicago area, but we knew Ikra. When I was in Sunday school, we used Ikra's books. And when we heard Ikra wanted to do a show, you know, we made it a priority to make sure we worked this out. And there's a few heroes in the Muslim community, and this family is definitely one of them. We also have another friend that we want to welcome, Russia and Rusty, can stand up. Stand up, please. You guys don't know them yet, but you will know them. They came all the way from Michigan just for the show. And the lady standing up is actually an incredible, the lady standing up is an incredible artist, and she's just illustrated a book. What she's done in the book is she's taken Arabic letters, so like example, like the Ba and the Alif, and she's taught how the letters are formed using stories. So for example, the Alif is like a tall man, and the Hamza is a hat that goes on, a bird that goes on top of the Alif. And it's an incredible, so she's showing us the book for the first time. It's incredible work, so I'm gonna actually ask her after the show if she can run and get it, so we can show some people, but it's an incredible work, and we're, Dawud and I are so excited to see the final product. Anyways, we wanna thank all of you for coming. There's a lot of old friends in this audience, and we really, really are happy, and I really wanna thank one more time an incredible artist that we're once again honored to listen to. Yeah. Dawud, I want to give you one more time to Mr. Wharnsby.
I'm going to step in. I'm going to sing a couple of songs for you guys. Yeah. What we want to do is, we do want to invite all the children up and take a group shot. You know, so if all the children can come up and if you can walk along this side, and then we'll move these things. We're going to take a little group shot. Like, so, come up on the stage.
So there's a table.
Oh, just at the back.
So again, thank you for coming, Inshallah. That was going to be in front signing. So pick up a book, Inshallah. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay. Thank you so much.
We have a couple of